Hello everybody, it's your boy XXGeodudeXX coming with you with another video. This time it's going to be a podcast, and the podcast, it's a new series I want to start on this channel. I just finished filming one with a guest. You guys will see once I'm done with this. I just wanted to say I want to apologize for my quality of audio on my end recording. I don't know what the hell happened. I thought I sounded clear and nice and whatnot, but I sound like loud and kind of distorted and just kind of annoying. There's like an annoying fan blowing in the background. I don't know what the hell it is. I think it's my, because I have heat coming out right from under my chair, so it's probably blowing to the mic. So please bear with my part of the podcast. Pip sounded great, but I sounded awful. But hope you guys enjoyed the podcast. Leave a like, comment, let me know what you guys thought of it. And I'll be having a lot more guests. So, like I said, please bear with my part of the audio when recording my stuff. So, thank you very much. Enjoy the podcast. Have a good one. Bye. All right. We are live. This is nice. All right. So, I'd like to welcome everybody to the podcast. I have no name for it. I'm just going to call it the XXGeodudeXX podcast for now until we come up for a name. The only reason I wanted to start doing this is because I like having conversations and like talking about different things in life, video game, and whatnot. Our first guest that we're going to have on is my man, Piff Batman.
What's up? What's up? Thank you for having me. Really appreciate it.
And this is going to be... Hell yeah. I'm very excited to do the very first podcast with my man. I like to start out with, well, I personally know who you are, but for the people that don't know, who are you? What's your name?
What's my speciality? No, I'm just kidding. Yeah. hello, everybody. For those who don't know me, I'm Piff Batman. A lot like Geo, you know, stream, video game all the time. And I wish I was as good looking as Gio. Maybe one day. I don't know. But
one day.
Yeah.
One day. Okay. So what is? Let's start off with Twitch. What is your Twitch name, and what's your story on Twitch so far?
My Twitch username is Piff Batman. No spaces. No underscores or anything like that. I started Twitch like a really, really long time ago, pretty much when it became Twitch, you know, switching over to Justin.tv. Really, I just kind of started on Twitch just to, you know, just like anybody else, just watching people. When I first started watching, everybody was playing either Counter-Strike Source or fucking, you know, like World of Warcraft, which were like the two games that I really liked. So it was really easy for me to just watch those people. And I would say probably about 85% of the people that are, like, really popular on Twitch now were not there before. I recently picked up streaming. You know, several times I've done streaming, but, like, really consistently probably about 2 years ago. And just been grinding ever since, you know, enjoying the grind, enjoying meeting new people like yourself and a bunch of other friends. And just having a good time playing games and you know, having good conversations.
Okay, that's... So, you started exactly when? What was your first day of streaming or signing up for Twitch?
My first... the day that I started my account, I believe, was like December of 2012. So I think that was a little... about a year or so before Twitch had started. You know... pretty much the beginning. Not a lot happened in the first year of Twitch, trust me. I was pretty much there. It was very rough around the edges. A lot of people didn't think it was going to last very long, actually.
Did people think it was just... blow up. People thought it was just going to be a flop?
Yeah, I mean, like, 2011, 2012, which, you know, really didn't sound like that long ago, but, like, a lot of people, you know, the YouTube hype was, like, so new to a lot of people still, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And... a lot more people thought, you know, YouTube is where it's going to be at, you know, it's on demand, you know, people have, I mean, there's just so many people on YouTube now, like it's just so popular And a lot of people, when Twitch first came out, they were just like, well, why would I want to watch this person just sit here and play video games like live, you know?
Yeah, it
So.
when you explain a thing that I've noticed, I've been on this website for almost 2 years now, and the thing that's hard to explain to people that don't know what streaming is, it what we do. It's like, oh, so what's like, you go up to someone and they're like, oh, what's streaming? And you're like, well, you just kind of sit down, play video games, and talk with a bunch of strangers. And to them, that sounds like such a weird concept to
It
them.
just sounds so silly, yeah, for
It
sure.
sounds so
But
silly.
it's just so much more to that, you know? Like it's an experience, really.
Yeah.
That's kind of the only way I can explain it. It's just an experience.
And the thing about streaming is it's not easy. A lot of people think it's easy that you could just sit down, play video games, talk to strangers, but there's a lot more that goes into it, like setting up, well, for like a PC streamer, you have to set up your microphone, the game, the volume of the game, the volume of your mic. Does the game run well? There's just so many kind of things that go into it.
So and really it comes down to, how serious do you want to be about it, right? Is if you want to be anything more than just like a, really, really casual kind of streamer that just doesn't really, you just go live just to, because you already play video games 12 hours a day, you know what I'm saying? You might as well just go live and still play and not really do anything. Then yeah, you're gonna have to put a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of money, unfortunately, which is one of the things that, especially with these up and coming streamers, may not have, the resources to do so. And unfortunately, it's coming to a point where quality in terms of just like the setup and the equipment is becoming almost too focused on, like they're forgetting what the real, you're not selling your setup, right? Like you're selling yourself as a streamer if you want to be successful. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, yeah, you put a lot of time and effort into the material things. But the most where at least I spend my time, and some people have it better than others, in terms of just having that sort of personality and stuff like that. But it's just how you just show yourself to the to your stream, to your viewers, to the camera, how are you when nobody's watching or anything like that.
Yeah, with Twitch, it takes a lot of personality to make it out there. You could be like I've seen a lot of streamers where they're just very bland. They just care more about the gameplay and they don't really interact with their audience, and that's not really the whole purpose of it. I like watching someone with a bright personality. They're laughing, they're getting into it. They're interacting with the chat. They're having a great time. They're not just sitting there like bored out of their minds, because like it's an entertainment. You're entertaining people. People are coming home from a long day of work and they're looking forward to watching their favorite streamer for like an hour or two and sitting down and interacting with them. And let's say you had a bad day and you know the streamer you're watching has a great personality, that's going to cheer you up and that's going to keep them coming back to you. And that's something that a lot of people don't understand, because you're an entertainer. Your audience is watching you because they like you.
And that takes a lot of effort, and like you were saying before, it sounds silly, right? Like it's not easy being a streamer. Like obviously, like that's something that like a lot of people dream of doing, and they would pick that over a normal 9 to 5, you know what I'm saying? But it's very stressful in its own way, and again, like really how much time and effort and money you put into it. It can be really, really stressful for a lot of people, and some people just can't, that like a lot of people, that's what people don't tell you about, right? Like the really popular people on here, or even semi-popular who've seen success, they don't tell you that part, like how much it's stressful in terms of constantly looking at numbers. Obviously, the numbers play a big part. Concurrent viewers plays a big part, and you know, stuff like that. What baffles me, and when I say baffles, that I don't mean like confuses me. It's kind of silly to think about, but like there's people who they start Twitch, right? Like they make an account and they're on Twitch for a couple months and they say, you know what, I'm gonna try it out. You know, like why not? You know, they like, I like this guy a lot, he's cool, I wanna be like him, he's popular, let's try this out. And then they spend this ridiculous amount of money, or not, you know, it doesn't matter, but let's say they spend a ridiculous amount of money and they go live, you know, everything's official, they got the overlay, they got the setup, they're ready to go. And then, you know, they get nobody for their first stream, their second stream, third stream. And it's a month or so, and they're just like, this is dumb. Like, why am I doing this? Why am I wasting my time? And honestly, it's hard to... Until you stop thinking about, like, the numbers and stuff like that, that's all you're ever going to have. And you're really... You're just never going to actually see the progress that you're making, whether it's with people or whether it's with yourself. And I think that's what's important, like seeing the progress in yourself before. Because if you don't see the, you know what I'm saying? Like if you don't see the progress in yourself, you're not going to see progress anywhere, because you're just kind of that same mindset over and over again. It's like, I'm not good enough. This isn't good enough. It needs to be better. Blah, blah, blah. And you're constant. It's just a cycle. You know what I'm saying? It's just a circle over and over and over and over again.
Yeah. With what you just said, like, I'll be honest, when I was streaming off of my PS4 and kind of grew with numbers and stuff, everybody's like, upgrade to a PC and make your streams a little bit more better quality-wise. So I said, okay. I saved up my money, looked into some PC parts, bought everything, and I honestly thought that with a nice PC, I thought I was going to get, like, 50 viewers, like, off the bat. Like, oh, you have a PC... Yeah. I have no idea why that was my mindset, because like, I spent all this money, so I should get a lot of people. Yeah. But it never really came into fruition with everything that I bought. And I'm happy with what I bought and whatnot, but I was being naive and dumb about it, thinking that, well, I have all this nice stuff, so everybody's going to come in and watch me, and that either the numbers stay the same or they drop. And for me... A lot of the time they dropped, and it made me really upset and whatnot, but at the end of the day, you have to understand that people are going to watch you for you or for your gameplay. It doesn't really matter, like, if you have, like, the best layout, the best microphone, the best whatever, people are still going to come in and watch you for you if you're entertaining.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. I think it would be naive to say that some of that stuff doesn't play a factor for some of these people. You know, like having a good production quality definitely helps with like a really small niche on Twitch. And I think you right? Would you agree with me in saying that?
Yeah, yeah, I would.
You know what I'm saying, like having like really like almost like show like TV quality kind of stuff, whether it's your webcam or animated overlays or something like that. But yeah, and it's not crazy to have that sort of feeling, is that when you put all this time and this money and effort into, you know, upgrading that stuff, because you see it work with some people. So I mean, I'm not berating those people, but you need to understand, like, you're putting time and effort and money into this for people to, here's how I see it. You're trying to sell yourself to where people are willing to spend, and I say this all the time. I say this all the time. You can vouch for me. Anybody else can vouch for me. But you are selling yourself to people to spend the most valuable asset that they can ever offer anybody, and that is their time. Mm-hmm. That is the one asset that any human being on this planet can never get back. So that is the mindset that I go into whenever I hit the go live button, and you would be incredibly surprised like how that changes your mentality, especially if there's nobody in there. You know, like, especially if nobody's watching you. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just when you have that sort of thought process, like, okay, when people, even if one person comes in here, right? Like, I'm gonna treat like that person is the freaking man. You know what I'm saying? Like, you are here, you're hanging out with me. You could literally be doing a trillion other things right now. But instead, you're here talking to me, watching me play this game and wanting to share this experience with me. And for me, that just like at that point, I don't give a crap what else you do. I don't care if you sub to me. I don't care if you give me money. I don't care. I do not care. I would rather have people like appreciate and feel like they're not wasting their time watching me than trying to like throw money at me or anything like that, because I'm not reading their chat or something like that and they're just trying to ask me a question.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you 100% with that, because people have lives and they could do 100 other things. Like, people go to school, people have jobs, people have families, people have kids to take care of, or people just simply just want to do things on their own. And the fact that they come into your stream, spend an hour of their day, an hour out of the 24 hours in a day to hang out with you, or two or three, that is incredibly awesome, because, like you said, you could be doing 100 other things, but yet you're hanging out with me. Have you ever looked on your, like, your leaderboards, and you see, like, all the hours that people have dedicated to, like, your stream? That is insane, because they could, all those hours, they could have been doing anything else, but they were with you, watching your stream, interacting with you, hanging out with you, talking with you, and that's just, when you think about it, like, damn, that's pretty nice that people are coming in and hanging out with you.
Yeah, just to add a quick comment, especially with you, I think that really, like, I see your dedicated hours for people, and, like, that shit baffles the hell out of me. Like, there you have, I think you, at this point, you have, what, two or three people now that probably have, what, over 400, 500 hours in your stream?
That is insane.
Like, that is literally insane.
Like, that is a lot of hours dedicated to hanging out with someone.
Yeah.
And I'm very grateful for all those people. I'm very grateful for everything that's happened here in the past 2 years and meeting everybody that's been here. Just a quick comment, you know, I'm very happy to have met you, Piff. I like to repeat our story time to time. I know.
It's like a love story.
It is a love story, pretty much. So, like, for the people that are watching this podcast and don't know, me and Piff, we met each other on Twitch. It all started when I was playing Star Wars Battlefront 2015. I was just streaming one day, and then I get hosted by him, or raided by Piff Batman. And then next thing you know, like, his audience comes in, hangs out with me, and I still remember Piff was like, "Hey, this is actually a pretty cool stream. Like, what's up?" And I was like, "Oh, hey, what's up, Piff? Batman, like, how you doing?" And then next thing you know, I start hanging out with Piff and his streams, and we had a legendary 1v1 that was incredible. Well, we had two 1v1s. The first 1v1, you absolutely destroyed me. You were Vader.
Yeah.
I was Luke. You just annihilated me.
It was epic, though. It was epic.
Yeah. And then our second 1v1 with Han and Boba. Oh, my.
That was even more crazy.
We
were both screaming.
I was in my room screaming my head off, like, just die already. And, yeah, I'm very grateful, because the people that still hang out with me in that stream, a lot of them came from Piff, and they hang out with both of us, and I'm very grateful for Piff. Piff, we've been friends for, like, a year and a half now.
Yeah.
Almost 2 years now. And we went to TwitchCon together, and we got to meet each other, and that was pretty dope.
That was a one-in-a-lifetime experience, honestly. And I say once-in-a-lifetime, but we're also going to go this year. So
yeah, TwitchCon 2018, wherever it is, we're going. And it's crazy, because there was a chance you were not going to go to that.
Yeah, so it's been, you know, the last year has been really trying, you know, especially, like, financially wise. I don't know if that's, like, the correct way to say it, but, you know, I pretty much moved out of my parents' house when I was, like, right when I turned 18, and ever since then, it's been kind of, like, I wouldn't say a struggle. Like, it's been really nice, like, living by myself, but it's also, like, a huge rude awakening. You know,
mm-hmm.
And it's pretty much always been live paycheck to paycheck and a bunch of other, you know, private personal stuff that I don't want to get into. But basically, yeah, so I save up some money for this Twitch contract. And for people that don't know, we started planning this trip like a while, like this the beginning of last year, you
Yeah,
know?
yeah.
Like we started like really early trying to get, at least some rough numbers going on.
Yeah.
And I started saving up for it, and then I drive the first car. I still drive my first ever car that I ever bought like 5 years ago. And it was already a piece of crap car then. It's obviously time doesn't do any better to it. So basically the fuel cap, or no, the fuel pump, excuse me, my car just completely goes out. Now, my car's old, so it's harder to work on. So all the quotes I were getting were like, I mean, pretty much, I wouldn't say drain everything, but drain a pretty good amount of stuff, of finances. And so, thankfully, I was able to get a guy who was actually local who cut me a really good deal, and was willing to pay for the part for me, and I would just charge him for labor. And that was, that helped me able to go and really enjoy the trip. And got to experience the beauty of California. Like, that was the furthest west I've ever been. First time I've ever been in California, I think, for all of us. And it was so worth it. Absolutely worth it. I had a fantastic time. I was so able. I was so glad that I was able to go. And I don't regret anything.
Yeah, when you told me, like, yeah, there's a chance I'm not gonna go anymore, I'm like, dude, what the hell? Like, are
It
you
was really
serious?
sad.
I was legit upset because, well, one, I was looking forward to meeting you because we've been friends for a while, and just the fact that we've been planning it for months and then, like, what, a week before, you're like, yeah, I might not be able to go. And that, I'm just really happy you're able to go and that we met each other. And California was very beautiful, very warm, beautiful. We walked from our apartment all the way to Long Beach. Oh my God, it was like
All the way to the convention center or
what, a
something?
2 hour walk, 3 hour
Yeah,
walk?
2 hours.
Oh my God,
Like
dude.
two something hours, man. I mean, it was beautiful. Like, there was
Yeah.
so much to see. We got to walk off the coast and stuff like that, which was awesome. But damn, like, yeah, that was 2 hours. I was not expecting that walk
Yeah, I
to be as
thought.
long as it was.
Yeah, like the whole Long Beach. I can see why they call it Long Beach now. It's. Yeah, but it was definitely an awesome experience. Had a lot of fun at TwitchCon. I know you met a lot of streamers, a lot of big time streamers there, and got to talk to a lot of
definitely.
game developers. Got to talk to a bunch of people working on their art, like the artists, people working on like new, like, well, what would it be, like video game stuff,
Yeah,
hit
just like
like.
graphic design and also a lot of like cool peripherals and hardware. And like, I wasn't expecting so many like sponsors to be there. Like, people, like, they're actively looking for streamers and stuff like that. And I think that was really cool of them to be able to house that in like a what really felt like a expo show floor.
It was huge. The
It
convention
really
center
did.
was huge. It was ridiculous, and it was cool seeing the H1Z1 tournament. It sucks seeing Doc getting knocked out. The guy who won, I forgot his name, but
Yeah, dude, I totally forgot.
Sandy
He was in
Ravage or something like
That's
that.
what it was. I was
Yeah.
thinking Orb, but I think Orb was runner up.
Yeah. And that was pretty cool seeing that. And I thought it was also cool, like, talking to game developers about their games and how passionate they were about it. And just seeing the progress and whatnot. And you took pictures with Soda Poppin.
Yeah, Soda Poppin' and Wreckfold together. They were just chilling. Nobody was talking to them, so I was like, "The hell!" This is like the probably the only time I'll ever get to do this. And they were cool with it. They were like, "Yeah, let's take a picture," and that was that.
And what about Summit?
All right, well,
To explain that story?
the whole Summit story. So, a friend of ours, Gamer811, me and him, and this was right after the 2 hour walk that we had just had. This was the first day. This is that Friday of TwitchCon, the first time they opened the show floor for everybody. the first thing that me and Gamer do, we walk to near the back was where they were all doing like the meet and greet. You wait in the line, you get to meet them, take a picture, all that stuff. And so we wait in line. It's by far the longest line. I wouldn't say the longest line, because he had the same time as Dr. Disrespect. That was like a little further, and I would say Docs was probably a little bit longer, but they were still both like ridiculously long. And so we're just sitting here waiting, and the guy that like kind of like cuts people off every now and then, kept saying over and over again, he's like, you know, once what if you're not at my point right now, there's a chance you're probably just not going to see him. It's not really any point of being able to like walk through. And for the most part, me and Gamer's like, yeah, we're here, whatever. Let's just stay committed. We got this. And then it gets to like we're pretty close at this point, but it's also like 20 minutes past Summit's time. Like his time slot was over like 20 minutes ago. We're still waiting in line, and the guy's like, all right, literally, like if you're not like in the front, you're wasting your time. And so I was like, you know what, man, it's fine. I'm just gonna go. I'm gonna go walk around. There's a bunch of stuff to do. I haven't even like looked everywhere yet. And then Gamer's like, nah, you know what? I'm just gonna wait it out. Whatever. I've waited this long. Might as well keep going. And I said, all right, man, whatever. And so I walk away, and I shit you not, like 45 seconds after I walk away, they literally let Gamer through. Like Summit like waves up. He's like, all right, just let a few more people come in, and that's it. And they literally cut it off right after Gamer. I could not believe, and he called me. This dude called me through the line. He's like, "Do you see me right now?" And at the time, I was like, "No, where are you at?" He's like, "Look behind you." And he's like 2 people away from meeting Summit right now. I was like, "You've got to be fucking kidding me!" Like, I could not believe it. And that's not even the worst part. So Gamer comes up to them. Okay, so it's Summit, and then with all the streamers, they get to have like a plus one, right? Like just sit there with them. So it's Summit and his friend Miniker, who also streams, really cool guy. They stream all the time together, and so they're sitting there together, and you know everything's all peachy and fine. And Gamer's like, you know, hey, I really appreciate you staying a little bit longer. They were like, all right, cool. And I'm over here on the side with like, I'm like, giving the death stare to Gamer right now. Like I'm so, I know it's not his fault, but like I was so upset, so mad. And so I was just sitting there, and God, and so like he's about to take a picture with Summon and Miniker, and all of a sudden, this dude comes out like from the back and like high five Summit, says what's up to Miniker, and it's freaking Shroud. I could not freaking believe that Shroud just comes out at the same time the Gamer goes up to take a picture. I was like, are you serious? And there was somebody else too. There was like one other person, and I can't remember who it was. I'm sorry. It was either Jericho, it was Shorty Guy, and I can't remember which one it was, but that's besides the point. This dude literally gets to meet four of arguably the biggest people on Twitch, right? Especially with Shroud at Summit. And so he literally gets a picture with all four of them and pretty much nags the entire the rest of the weekend. He just nagged me the rest of the weekend about it. And pretty much to this day, he'll like, including you, obviously, for making me retell the story again. I'm never going to be able to live that down, ever. That's probably the only chance. Watch this year, we go to TwitchCon, and like Summit's literally just like chilling in the corner. I'm like, yo, what's up, Summit? He's like, sup. I was like, want to take a picture? He's like, all right. I'm gonna be like, yo, I waited in your line for an hour last year.
My God, dude. I remember how salty you were about that.
I was really mad, but like 20 minutes later, that's when I met Soda and cool. So yeah, I was fine. I was fine after that, but.
It was cool, like when we went to the Halloween party at the pier,
Yeah.
and we
That was
just walked by him
really
and
cool.
we're like, "Hey, Sub." He's like, "Yo," like
He
just
was
so
literally like
casual.
every 5 seconds, like people were like, "Sup, Summit?" And he's like, "Sup, yo." Like
Yo,
so just chill. Like he was wearing like this button-down flannel shirt with glasses. Like I've never seen this dude wear glasses ever.
whatever.
And just wearing the same hat you always see him wear on stream and stuff like that. He's like, yo. So like no, we were like walking behind him for like the longest time, trying to
Yeah.
get to, because we thought like the we were like looking for like the haunted like walkthroughs or whatever, and we thought we were going to one, but we were actually going to like some VIP lounge.
Yeah, we were going through
But that's
like
when
the
like we
big
were like
streamers.
literally walking. We were literally like walking right behind him and Miniker. Like literally right behind them. And I literally would have stopped them and asked for a picture, but like it was so crowded, like you could not move, and I felt like I would have been like that would have been such a dick move for like me to like literally stop the entire line and just disrupt everything that's going on just to take a picture of Summit.
Oh man. Damn. Yeah, it was cool seeing him like in person. I thought personally, with these big time streamers, you'd think they would have like a group of people surrounding them, like fangirling them, mm-hmm. but no, they're just like everyday
people.
Yeah, I don't think
I saw anybody like when I saw Soda Poppin' and Rec Bull, they were like literally just by themselves, and it's not like they were tucked away in a corner or anything like that. They were just out in the middle of the open, and nobody walked up to them. It was so weird. Like the only person that I saw ever have an entourage, and I think I told you this, is when I saw like Rice Gum, like out of like walking out of.
Oh room. Yeah, dude.
This dude literally had two bodyguards, like two huge like bodyguards next to him, and then like a group of like young, like these people were kids behind him. Like I'm not even kidding. Like it was just like an entourage of kids like walking. It's like my first thing I like looked at him. First thought I was like, dude, this dude is even uglier in person. But then I was also like, why are you at TwitchCon? Like.
Yeah, what do you...
I mean, I know you used to stream on Twitch and stuff like that,
mm-hmm.
but I would definitely say that, like, YouTube is made like has made him bigger than I think he's ever thought he was ever going to be.
Mm-hmm.
So, it was just really weird.
Yeah, when you told me, like, yeah, I saw Rice Gum, I was like, what? What? Yeah, are you serious? That was funny, because when we saw him, that was, like, the end of the whole like content cup with iDubbbz and the music video, and I thought people were like gonna make jokes at him, but no, I was very.
Yeah, but I'm pretty sure nobody yelled at him because of the two giant ass bodyguards right next to him.
Well, they like 6'5", like 250.
Oh, dude, easily.
Oh my god!
Like they were gigantic.
Damn, but hey, the. Overall, TwitchCon was a good experience. I enjoyed it a lot. Definitely going to be going great this year with you, Gamer Blink, and then we'll see if anybody else.
Somebody else will come.
Yeah, definitely. So, let me ask you this: what's your opinion on Twitch as a whole now compared to when you started? Like, what's?
Oof, man, it is different. So, and like that's really easy for me to say because like a lot of people that are on Twitch now really weren't there before, like near the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just really, really different. I mean, I never would have ever thought that we would have gotten like some sort of category for people to literally just like sit down and just like talk in front of a camera. You know, like that whole IRL category, mm-hmm. all that stuff. I never thought that would have happened because when they first announced Twitch and when people were like moving over to Twitch from Justin. Justin.tv was a lot for podcasting, web shows, and the occasional person will play video games. Like some people will play RuneScape and stuff like that. But then when Twitch came along, the whole thing was like gaming. You know what I'm saying? Like they wanted to get their name out for like all these gaming companies. Like, hey, broadcast your games on Twitch. Like this is what we're doing, right? Like it was so focused on. Just the games.
Mm-hmm.
I would say honestly, they were focused more on the games than they were on the people that were streaming those games, because mm-hmm. they were really, really, really trying to get some. At the beginning, they didn't have the rights to stream some of these games because these video game companies have never like thought of this before. You know what I'm saying? Like to like live stream them. It was one thing to have like a video made from it and stuff like that, and do some sort of walkthrough, but to do it simultaneously, like a lot of people were like, well, you know. How is that going to happen? and now it's a giant. Like, I would say definitely more people know what Twitch is than people who don't know what Twitch is. At least know what it is. And the whole thing of like, I think Twitch is coming more into entertainment just in general with, mm-hmm. you know, the IRL category. And now they're about to do their own show. Seeing it, they're like advertising like, stream on or something.
Oh
like,
yeah,
like, I auditions for it or something like that.
I've been seeing the advertise commercials for that.
Something like that. I don't remember what it's called exactly.
But, yeah, it's Stream On.
Yeah. And there's trivia shows and in esports. Obviously, is like blown up so much, and I think Twitch really has to do with a lot of that. It's crazy. You know what I'm saying? Like just to see it grow the way it's grown, and Yeah, I mean, different. I guess that's really the thing that I could say. It's just different. Like I would have never thought. I don't think anybody would have ever thought it would have grown as much as it did.
There's definitely a whole lot of people streaming. Like I said, I've been here for only 2 years, and you've been here for a lot longer than I have, but like it's definitely for me, even in 2 years, it has changed a lot. There's all like an insane amount of streamers trying to make a name for themselves out there, and if I feel like if you start now, it's kind of harder because it's oversaturating the website with more streamers. And it's still a good time, but one thing I don't like about Twitch is just the whole like IRL section. And don't get me wrong, I love girls as much as the next guy, but what the hell is going on with the whole
A
IRL?
lot.
All the titty streamers just sitting there like with their tits out.
Yeah.
And I know we've talked about this before, but
Yeah,
it's just like it's,
yeah.
oh my God.
Well, I think it's safe to say that Twitch, obviously, I really don't think they were expecting it to turn the way into it did. Like, you know what I'm saying? I don't think they expected all these all the I'm not going to just say cam girls, even though that's a lot of part of it, but just these people that do really like dumb stuff. You know what I'm saying? There's a guy like for example, and I told you this, and I told a lot of people this. The one of the first things that I saw in the IRL category, it was two separate streams, right? It was one guy who literally turned his stream on and then went to sleep, and people stream were like he streamed him sleeping, and there was about 250 people watching him, and then the per and then the stream right after that one with like the little less amount of viewers, it was like 175 people. It was a guy watching the dude that was sleeping. That was it. And so like at the time I was like at the time I thought it was really fun. Like I was like, okay, this okay, so IRL, this is what pretty much IRL is. Like it's just gonna be, like people just like making fun or like making jokes or something like that. And then obviously, as we know, it kind of took a complete 180. And it's become really toxic. And it's sad too, because there's some people on IRL category that travel and just want to share their experience of traveling. Like Wreckful kind of gets a lot of shit for having like toxic stuff, but this past summer, I believe, they were in he traveled Europe and he went to Japan and all that stuff, and he pretty much streamed the entire time he was in Europe, and like he sightseed everything and everything was on stream, and it was beautiful. And I think that's kind of what they were wanting to go for. I think that's more of the content they were trying to lean for with IRL, as well as like the people that would sit down and just talk to their community and have like a web show or something like that. I think that's what they were trying to do. But then obviously, like I said, you just see the amount of people that are moving over to Twitch from different back then from different websites, and this certain these certain people, people that are cammings, webcamming sites and stuff like that, see that as an opportunity to generate income and to have an audience, because they understand that a lot of these people on Twitch are, kind of growing males, and obviously that's going to appeal really quickly to them.
Kids hitting puberty and growing up between like the ages of like 14 to 17, and they see a girl with a pretty face and they're just like, oh my God, this is the greatest thing ever. Here, take my money, take
They're
all my
lucky.
money.
They're lucky. They're 14 now, and they have this stuff for free, and they don't have to hide it. They don't have to delete their history. I mean, I was 14, and Twitch was still a thing then, I think. What was that? Damn. Like 8 years ago. So no, yeah, Twitch wasn't even a thing. So like, I had to, use incognito mode, shit like that, and try to sneak in the bathroom or something like that. So these kids have it easy nowadays with finding some spank bank content.
Yeah, I definitely agree with you with that one. Like, it blows my mind that there's guys that donate an insane amount of money to these girls. It's just like, why? Do you think like she's gonna have sex with you or something if you donate all this money? Like, no, she's gonna take your money, be thankful, and be like, all right, thanks, bye. But When I first heard of the IRL category being released, that's what I was thinking, what you were saying with people traveling and just sitting down talking with their audience. Like sometimes there's some days you just don't even feel like gaming and streaming. You just want to like sit down and talk with your audience.
And that's fine. I don't see, like I said, like that's cool. Some people are really good at that. And that's cool to watch sometimes. You know, have some good music going on, and if you got stories to tell, then by all means sit in the chair, play some chill tunes, and tell it. Tell your stories. You know, like that's cool for some people. I
Yeah,
don't have a problem with that.
exactly. I have no problem with that either. That's what it's meant for. But like you said, you have these girls dressing provocatively, and like I said, I love girls as much as the next guy. But it's just this is Twitch. This is meant for gaming. This is for us to get away from our real life problems for a couple hours, sit down, game, talk with our friends that we make on Twitch. And that's it, gaming. That's the main structure of Twitch, but it's.
And I agree with you and all that stuff, but I would definitely say even before the IRL category was a thing, the people that we were talking about earlier in the podcast with, you know, they were trying to get started and stuff like that. A lot of people are saying, you know, like they're stealing the, like these girls are stealing viewers, like they don't want to watch anything but these girls, which, you know, for some of those viewers, yeah, that's true. But I mean, here's another thing with when you need to have like this mentality of like of really just focusing on yourself. Like, don't, like, yeah, okay, I get it, like it's changing the whole thing on Twitch, it's changing the whole environment, right? Like, it's a certain thing in the environment now, but like you still need to just focus on yourself. Like, that's not, at this point, that's not going, it's not going anywhere, right? Like, and we can sit here and we can talk about it and say this fucking sucks, like, you know, whatever, like, yeah, that's all true, but, you know, okay, I mean, are we just gonna sit there and constantly use it as an excuse? Because I'll tell you right now, even before the IRL category existed, people found other things to bitch about, to say, to like give like excuses for why they're not being as successful as some other people, you know, and it's like, I would definitely say this is the worst excuse or most valid excuse, but it's still what it is, right? It's an excuse.
Yeah, definitely. There's still many ways to make yourself successful on
There
Twitch.
is,
You
yeah.
just have to show off your body. There's people that like our friend Blink. She watches Skyhooks, and she makes like some awesome art. And you know,
Great art, great art, yeah.
she's not like showing off her body or anything. She's just making some great art, and she's gotten pretty big off of that. And it's that she's using her creative abilities to put a name for herself out there. And well, there's people that I've seen people play piano live on stream, or guitar, or drums and stuff, and that's just a whole nother way to put themselves out there. And there's people that are just ridiculous at a game. Some people that speed run, like I know, what's his name, Trihex.
Trihex, yeah, Trihex,
He
yeah.
I was watching him stream Mario Odyssey, speed running it. He beat it like in an hour. Like
Yeah,
that
insane.
is Super Mario Odyssey in an hour. That is just crazy. So there's definitely a whole lot of different ways to make a name and put yourself out there, and stop looking at others and comparing yourself to them, and just focus on
Yeah,
yourself.
you'll never get anywhere. And it goes back to the whole cycle. Like, if you compare yourself to others, you know, like you're already having to compete with yourself from your last stream. How do you better yourself? You have to better yourself every stream. Like, don't focus on, now you're just wasting more valuable resources and your time to have to worry about, okay, am I doing better than these other people? Like, don't worry about that. Just worry about yourself. Focus on yourself. Focus on bettering the overall quality of yourself, and then worry about about your stream, and you'll be fine.
Definitely, I definitely agree with you. Just focus on yourself, keep moving forward, and just don't look back. And people always said like, look at your past broadcasts and see what you did right and what you did wrong and learn from that. And the big thing is, as long as you're focused on the chat entertaining, and I know some people come in just to see your gameplay. They don't really care about you.
Yeah.
So maybe if you're like decent at a game, they'll stick around. But there's some people that are looking for like ridiculous people that know how to play a game really well. But a lot of people are just like, "Oh, this guy's cool. I'll stay here and chat with them and stick around for a bit or
Yeah.
and whatnot." But let me ask you another question.
Yeah.
Well, I'm gonna ask you two. What is your favorite thing about Twitch, and what's your least favorite thing about Twitch?
Favorite thing about Twitch is how easy it is to get involved in communities and then meet new people. I really see it as like just a new kind of social gathering site, you know? And being able to just like get on a website and just watch somebody or whatever, talk to somebody, and then also talk to these other people that are literally across the entire world and just have like a conversation about like something that you both like or maybe have like contrasting ideas and you know what I'm saying? And being able to do that at like all centralized, that's probably my favorite thing on top of, you know, the MLG gameplay from XXGeoDudeXX. But
That guy's cool.
but my least favorite thing on Twitch, that's a really tough question. Probably again, kind of going back, it's those people that focus too much on the numbers and not seeing the results they would want to see from the stuff, you know, from the resources they're putting in. And I guess that has to do with both Twitch and Twitter, because you know a lot of these people go to Twitter to express that. And you know, I don't ever say anything. I don't ever comment onto them, but you know, these people, they don't owe you anything, and it's a privilege to get people into your stream and again give you their time. And instead of just, you know, bitching about it on Twitter and stuff like that, like you're just, I don't know, you're just yelling into the void. Like nobody's gonna listen. Nobody's gonna want to watch you know?
Yeah, definitely.
I would definitely say that's probably my least favorite thing about Twitch, though. Definitely.
There's people that are like that don't get a certain number and they just quit streaming or end the
Yeah.
stream and whatnot, and that's just your people are just lucky to even have someone in their stream. Like when I first started streaming, I didn't have anybody besides my boy Blink.
Yeah.
Because I told him that I was gonna sign up for Twitch and he would hang out. But like it was just me and him for like the longest time, for like 3 months, until
Yeah.
I remember streaming Minecraft. I was streaming Minecraft one day and it was just by myself, and I had this one guy from the other side of the world, like part of Europe, part of like somewhere in Europe, and he just came in one day and we like talked for like an hour, and it was probably like what gave me more motivation to like continue streaming,
Yeah.
because like this person's coming into my stream, because you know how many people are streaming Minecraft. There's hundreds and
Yeah,
hundreds of people, but the fact he chose mine and stuck around for an hour and we just talked about whatever, it was very nice, and that opens up your eyes a little bit more, and then that's when like the snowball started rolling down a little bit more and more, when more and more people started coming in and watching, and it's very humbling to like look back at it compared to like you have people that show up to the stream no matter what, and those are the best type of viewers,
Yeah.
and compared to people that just come in like once a year, and it's very humbling to see, because like
Yeah.
I love Twitch. I'll be honest, like I love Twitch. It's awesome. If I didn't get myself in a car crash, I would have never signed up for Twitch. I know that sounds a little weird to say, because like, well, the story with that is, I bought a brand new car, and me and Blink were gonna go to a party, and I was driving and like my car had a like a touchscreen radio in the car, and I looked down for a second to change the song, and the person in front of me like slammed their brakes and I didn't see it, so I crashed right into them and whatnot, and I totaled my car and everything, and thankfully me and my best friend Blink, we were fine. It was awful. It was very traumatizing, and after that, I went home, and the next day I woke up. I didn't have a car, I didn't have anything, and I just loaded up my PS4, and I was just kind of looking through it. And I went to the PlayStation store, and I saw Twitch, and I was like, "What the hell is Twitch? Like, I don't know. Like, let me look at it." So I downloaded it, made an account, and started like going through it, and I'm like, I clicked on a random stream and it's just someone playing video games and talking to their audience. I'm like, oh, this is not bad. I could probably do this. Like, I have no, like, nowhere to go. I have no car. Let me just try it. And then ever since, it's been history, and here we are, almost 2 years later.
Almost 2 years later.
I hit my 2 year anniversary on the 11th of this month.
Nice.
And 2 years later, we started from zero. Now we're at 7,000 strong, and it's just been a hell of a ride. And 2018 is going to be a pretty awesome year with a lot of goals in mind. And speaking of that, do you, I know I asked you this before, but do you have any goals for 2018? Anything in particular you want to accomplish for the year of 2018
I
on
mean,
Twitch?
like you always want to be like, for a lot of people, like the goal is partnership, right? Like that's something that they aspire to do. I mean, it'd be awesome to get partnership this year, obviously. Like for me to not to say that would be dumb. Like that'd just be not true. But like I want to do a lot more than that. Like I want to keep, again, just like keep bettering myself. Like I feel like I'm not even close to what I could possibly do, just in terms of like me being entertaining and me really just trying to, find where I'm supposed to be. Like I'm not saying I'm like lost, right? But it's like I don't really know. I don't really know how to explain it. Like it's just you just I just want to be more focused, I guess. I guess one goal I would really like to have would be to just like finally, like it's hard having like a set schedule when you work full time and then you go to school full time as well. And it's just really hard to find time to just make a schedule. Like I've always been hesitant in like making a schedule because I always feel like, I don't know, I always feel so bad when I just miss a day, and like and the day becomes 2 days and 2 days becomes three. And so on and so forth, and that just looks really bad on me as a person and stuff like that. Like it says a lot about somebody. So I guess one thing would be to like, I graduate college this year, so once I finish school in like August, hopefully, I can have like a set schedule. Like just people will definitely know when I'll go live, for how long I'll be live and stuff like that. So. But besides that, no, man, I just keep doing what I'm doing. I guess meet you can always meet more people. Definitely talk to more people and hang out in more people's streams and just, share that community sense that, Twitch is really supposed to be about.
Yeah, a big community, all hanging out, having a good time. No competition really with each other. It's all a big support system on Twitch.
Yeah,
It's
definitely.
hard to have a set schedule, and one thing that kind of made me mad, like at the beginning of streaming on Twitch, is I used to stream like a lot, like every day for like hours, and then that just drains you after so many days of streaming for so many hours. It drains you. So you have to like take like a day off, and like people get pissed at you for taking a day off. Like, it's like, dude, are you serious? Like, I have to set aside some time for myself, rest up, get myself mentally prepared for like another month of streaming. Like, I just can't keep streaming, like, constantly, every day, for like 8 hours or whatever, and just be completely fine with it. It's very draining and very taxing on your body and brain.
Definitely.
And it's just, and then you kind of start to lose viewers, and that's ridiculous. Like, I'm not gonna watch this guy because he's not streaming every day. Like, bro, like, come on. I have a life. I understand these people are like teenagers, because when I was like 15, 16, I had nothing to do. I just went to school, and I mean, I did play football in the fall, but after that, I just went to school and then went home. And now I'm 22 years old. I was working two jobs, gonna be starting a full-time construction job here soon, and it's hard to maintain a consistent schedule with Monday through Sunday. Try to stream like 3 hours each day. It's just, some people can do that, and congrats to them.
Yeah,
But
definitely. Like some
I
people can
just,
do,
yeah.
yeah, some people can do. I read this blog post once, and it was, you know, how to gain success on Twitch. And I'll tell you right now, for any like, all those things are like they help, but there is no formula to be successful on Twitch. Like obviously, right? Like I think we all know that. And one of the things though that's actually a really valid point. Again, it comes down to scheduling. Is, you know, for these people that are not in school and they work, you know, 9 to 5s, there's people that, you know, it's like, you know, getting used to the lifestyle of doing a 9 to 5 and then 5 to 9. It's like you go to work 9 to 5, and then you stream, and obviously you don't get home at exactly 5. But you know, in that sort of sense of like, you know, making that a habit, and you know, and doing that, it just comes down to scheduling again. And when people know when you go live and stuff like that definitely helps. And you know, making sure people understand when you're not live is also, because when you stream every day and then you don't go live one day, like people obviously are going to notice it more. So, and I guess that's why a lot of people like myself really want to have like a sort of set schedule. That way, when I'm not live, people, it's not a surprise.
Yeah, like sometimes people are like, "Oh shit, this person just went live. Holy crap, it's been like 3 years. What's going
Yeah,
on?"
exactly.
Yeah,
Exactly.
it's a thing about Twitch also. It's kind of a luck of the draw, really. Like, some people gain success super fast early and they get partnered right away, or some people spend like 5, 10, 20, 30 their whole lives on this website and never find any kind of like success. And
It's definitely not cut out for everybody. Like,
yeah.
luck definitely plays a part in it.
Yeah, it's all really, how serious are you about this whole Twitch thing? But let me ask you another question. What was the first game that you streamed when you were on Twitch?
I had to think about that. Actually, no, I don't. I actually know what it was. It was, so the craze at the time were, you know, Cry, right? You know, Cry, right? Like, chaotic, cryotic. I don't know how to say his name. It's been like 8 years, and I don't know how to say his name. But Cry, him, and then PewDiePie back in the day before he was the thing he is now. He was actually like a really cool YouTuber to watch. And the two, like the game they played most was like Amnesia: The Dark Descent, and that was the first game that I ever streamed on Twitch. And it wasn't the game itself, but people were able to make custom stories of the game, like
Like a
instead of
mod.
having to play the campaign. Yeah, exactly, just like a little mod level or something like that of the game. And I loved playing those. Like, it was so much fun to play those. And I figured, you know, what like, why not? I'll stream it. I'll give it a shot on, you know, and this was probably about maybe like 6 or 7 months after I had started Twitch. After I was on Twitch, and it was okay. I would get like groups. I would get like 15, 20 viewers and stuff like that, which was awesome, obviously. But that was back when I was in, you know, I was like a freshman, sophomore in high school. You know, like I never took it seriously. I streamed like one or two times a week, just whenever I felt like it. But it was a lot of fun, and like I had like a really crappy computer, a really crappy webcam, a really crappy microphone, but I made it work. And I think that's what's important. And obviously, I think like back then it was more forgiving than it is now, but yeah, I just made it work. But yeah,
Nice.
that was the first game I ever streamed on Twitch, and I'm not ashamed to say that. Like I said, it was a really popular game with it, and I loved it.
Yeah, it's pretty much the game that made PewDiePie and KSI their gave him their fame. And wasn't it, I think it was like the free game of the month last month, I think, or 2 months
Yeah, on tw
ago.
yeah, on PlayStation, it was both of the both games.
Nice.
Like Dark Descent and Machine for Pigs.
All right, another question. This might be a long list for you, but can you
No, that's huge.
list the games that you have streamed from like the beginning all the way till now?
I
Yeah, I know. I told it's gonna be a long
Oh my
list,
God.
but like
Yeah, I was
the
gonna
major names, majors.
major names. Okay. Like I said, I started with Amnesia. And then after Amnesia, I went to Garry's Mod.
I've heard of Garry's Mod.
Yeah, Garry's Mod. I played like a lot of Prop Hunt and Death Run, I think it was what it was called. And then from Garry's Mod, I went to World of Warcraft. Streamed a little bit of World of Warcraft. And when I started streaming World of Warcraft, that's when I was watching Soda Poppin. That's when he was like kind of first hitting the scene. It was really funny to watch him because that's when he was like crazy. Like he would call Blizzard and like troll the hell out of him while he was like raiding or something like that. That like he was like he changed a lot. That like a lot on Twitch. He changed a lot. A lot of people don't talk about that anymore because it was such a long time ago. And he's a little different now, you know. But then man, he was like literally crazy. Like he has like a. I think he has like ADHD or something like that, and he like wouldn't take his meds and just stream and like just go crazy, and that made me pick up World of Warcraft, so that was pretty cool. Then from there, man, maybe like Call of Duty.
Which
I think I
one?
streamed a little. I think I streamed a little bit of like. The one before Black Ops 2, I think is what it was. Black Ops 2.
Okay.
No, was it? I can't remember. It was a Call of Duty, but I can't remember which one it was. But it was like way back then, and nobody watched me do. It doesn't matter that much. But, dude, it's been such a long time. Like, I really don't.
I know. That's why, like,
It's really hard to say.
I mean, it's been 5 years for you.
Besides that, though, it was a lot of, like, I took multiple breaks, and so like it's really hard for me to remember.
Did
I
you?
can't say though when I first. What were you gonna say?
I was gonna ask, did you ever like stream Destiny?
Oh yeah, I sure did. But that was when I almost started like doing it. Almost started when I started streaming regularly. I started streaming the Fallout series. So I beat Fallout 1 and 2 on stream, and like
Nice.
nobody will ever find that ever, or anything like that. Because I mean, I would have like it was like the same like two or three guys that would come in and watch me. So yeah, I beat those games, and then I went off to I played some Resident Evil games as well. Tried to speed run Resident Evil 4, did not work out very.
Why?
And then that I don't know because well one of the like. Favorite streamers, and we became good friends. He used to go by Dudley C underscore, but now it's just Dudley. He kind of was like one of the first people that started doing like speed running on Resident Evil, and like he did it like a lot on Resident Evil 3, and that was really cool to watch to see him do like strats and stuff like that, and that introduced me to other speed running and stuff like that. So I tried to do that myself, and like I said, it just did not work out for me at all, but I also didn't put in that much practice into it, so I mean, it is what it is. Then I started streaming. streamed a little bit of FIFA, just a little bit, not a whole lot, a little bit. And then I started streaming the first Destiny. And this is when Destiny had been out for like a year already, and I think they were already on like in the second DLC or something. And that drew a bit of a crowd because Destiny has always been popular on Twitch. And that's pretty much when Fallout 4 came out, and then Battlefront 2015 came out. And obviously, like the rest of that's history. I started playing Battlefront 2015 a lot, played a little bit of Fallout 4. Definitely had a lot, most of the viewers that I ever gotten was through Battlefront 2015, though, and that's how I met you, obviously, and I met a lot of these people. And now it's just, now at this point, I've cared less about the game I play. Like, I just play whatever game I want to play at this point. And I just, like, especially recently, I just have this mentality, like, I don't care. Like, if people want to watch me, they're going to. I really don't think it matters what game I play. And yeah, and I've been streaming. I didn't stream yesterday, but I've been streaming kind of consistently for the past like week or so, and people are stopping by. I've definitely noticed kind of getting just a few more people in every now and then, which is cool.
Oh yeah,
That's
definitely.
pretty much it. Like that was a tough question. Like man, just to like sit there and try to think about everything I've ever streamed.
I mean, obviously you're not gonna name every single game, but just like the
How
big.
creepy would that have been if I would like, all right, well, starting from 2012.
Just pull out a piece of paper, just everything that you've played
Yeah, I
on
know, right?
stream.
Yeah, totally.
Well, I already know the answer to this question that I'm about to ask, but I'm still gonna ask it anyways. What game gave you the most views on Twitch so far, and what's the most viewers you had streaming that game?
Yeah, so again, it was Star Wars Battlefront 2015. And I believe the most viewers I ever got was, it's always like really fuzzy, but it was almost 200, maybe a little bit more. I don't, no other game has like ever made me that, like even close to that, you know? And it was more because, I definitely drew a crowd that like really liked Star Wars and liked Battlefront, even though it wasn't the perfect game. But I really would like to say, like, I feel like a lot of part, a big part of it was like I was, and I'm no different now than I was then. You know, I'm still like I can be just as interactive as I was then. But definitely like, you know, being as like chatty and stuff like that as I was then definitely helps. Like people, when people come into a stream, they want to see somebody that's like really like enthralled in what they're doing and like talking and stuff like that. Like it's kind of boring to like walk into a stream or like go into a stream and see some like literally just somebody with a webcam on like sitting there, not saying anything, sucking in a game or something like that. So plus I was like so MLG at Battlefront, like who wouldn't want to watch me, you know?
Yeah, MLG,
Yeah.
that Boba Fett gameplay. Yeah, I remember that. I remember when we did our 1v1, there was like 170 people watching.
Yeah,
Like for
bro.
you, I had
It's
like
crazy.
six, and everybody was just like switching back and forth between both our
Yeah.
streams, and
Yeah.
that was pretty crazy. And yeah, I remember that, like coming into your stream, like the chat was just flying,
Yeah.
and just everybody's coming in, hanging out, having a good time, and now like we don't see those same people anymore, like almost 2 years now. It is what it
Yeah.
is.
It is what it is.
And, you know, hopefully those people that aren't coming in, hopefully they're doing good in life and whatnot. But to the people that stuck around, hell yeah. Shout out to you
Yeah.
guys.
Shout out to you. Yeah.
Yeah, so let's take a little break, like a little commercial break. Okay. Well, I'd like to give a shout out to my sponsors, Nobody. Okay, we're back from commercial break.
Yes. Any sponsors looking to get a fresh new project? Check
Yeah,
out. No, I'm just kidding.
if you guys want to sponsor this podcast, I know my mic sounds a little off right now, but yeah, check us out, and Apple if you want to sponsor, or Nike, Bikies actually, Babibas. All right, So, enough about Twitch. Let's talk about something else. Let me ask you this. What is your favorite game genre? Video game
Favorite
genre?
game genre? Definitely RPGs. Definitely RPGs.
Like what?
100%. No answer. No, I'm just kidding.
No Man's Sky.
Legend of Zelda, Fallout, Elder Scrolls, Final Fantasy, stuff like that. And then MMORPGs as well, obviously. I love World of Warcraft. It's just being able to have these ventures and just be, not to worry about your own life for a little bit and just live out this crazy adventure as somebody else. That's what's always appealed to me, especially when I was a little kid. Like Legend of Zelda, blew my freaking mind when I was a little kid.
Like what, Ocarina of Time and
Ocarina of Time, Majora's Mask, Wind Waker on the GameCube, and Twilight Princess and stuff like that. I played the shit out of all of them. Loved all of them. Yeah, I also played a lot of Star Fox. Star Fox was pretty cool too. And yeah, RPGs. I mean, I don't hate any of the game modes, like, or any of the game genre. I'm saying if I had to pick one, that was my favorite. I feel like RPG is like a really general answer, though. I feel like a lot of people like RPGs.
yeah, a lot. That's for me personally, that's my favorite game genre. I just love getting lost in a world as a character and leveling up and just getting stronger. I like starting from level 1 and then going all the way up to level 100 while getting like better gear, upgrading your stuff and whatnot. Personally, my favorite RPG I've been playing so far myself is Assassin's Creed Origins. That game is actually, it surprised me a
Pretty
lot
dope.
with how, yeah, it's pretty dope and it surprised me a lot to how much fun I've been having with it.
Nice.
It's, I like the history of Egypt. I've always been interested in that, and the combat feels nice, and the you get like stronger. It has like the same colors when you get better gear, like blues, rare. Purple's like super rare, whatever. Yellow's like legendary, whatever. I put like 16 hours into that game so far, and I've been having a lot of fun. It's definitely a game I recommend people checking out sometime. And
Nice.
another RPG I've been looking forward to is Kingdom Hearts 3. They're saying it's gonna come out this year, but I highly doubt it.
It's
It's,
possible. It's possible.
yeah, but it's gonna come out probably sometime, either Christmas, around the Christmas time, or be delayed to like next summer. That's my guess, but I'm definitely looking forward to Kingdom Hearts 3. Okay, so what's your least favorite game genre?
MOBAs.
MOBAs,
MOBAs, MOBAs, MOBAs.
like
Yes. Like League of Legends,
Paragon.
Dota, Paragon, Heroes of the Storm, Smite. I can't stand those games. I've played League of Legends before, yesterday or yesterday. Why the hell did I say yesterday? Like a long time ago. Long time ago. Like when League was not when I wouldn't say when League first hit the scene. But definitely like in its early days. I played a lot played a pretty decent amount of League with friends and stuff like that and a lot of Dota 2. But it's just man, I just I can't I don't I don't I really don't know what it is anymore with those types of games. It's just so I don't know, it's just like I don't know. It's just a small arena and then people fight, but then there's also like you hear like you see and there's trying to be like strategies, but realistically if there's no strategies, you just have one guy hiding in a bush and then you have one person watching each lane and then I don't know, man. I just can't get into it. I don't shit talk people that like it and stuff like that. Obviously people can like their own stuff, but I find no entertainment whatsoever. especially playing those games, like just at all.
Definitely not your favorite.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I don't know. I've watched League of Legend players. I've seen some Paragon gameplay, and I don't know.
Just weird, man. I don't know. Can't get into it.
It's crazy how much money League of Legends tournaments make.
Oh yeah, it's like now they have their own league, and you know, the LCS and stuff like that, and they obviously had that tournament, TI, I think is what it's called, the International. I'm pretty sure that's with League of Legends, and it was like multi-million. I think like first place took like $5 million or something like that, or maybe it was $1 million. I don't know. It was crazy. Like it's $1 million, like multi-million dollars now in just like just this one game. Like rolling in the dough. It's crazy.
Yeah, it is insane how much money is on the line for these tournaments, League of Legends and whatnot. It's oh, win $250,000 or win $1 million for winning this tournament, like just for a video game.
Yeah.
It is mind blowing, honestly. It's crazy. Like now, there's the Overwatch League. What do you think of that?
I'm really hyped. I've been hyped for it for a while. I've been trying to get people to be more hyped about it. Like I think it's gonna bring because it's like it's its own entity. Like we were just talking about a league with like League of Legends, Dota, and stuff like that. But those are still like a string of tournaments from like different tournament organizers. Counter-Strike is also another good example. Like you have different, or you have like DreamHack and E-League and ESL, ECS, but like all these different tournament, like esports organizations contributing to these, you know, tournaments and stuff like that. But Overwatch League is really the first thing that we're gonna see where it's just it's like it's sports. That's what it is. It's just sports. You know, you have teams like you have like teams representing cities now, and you know, wins count for this many points and stuff like that. Just from watching the preseason last month, I'm really excited for it, and like more people are getting hyped for it. The production value is awesome. I was not expecting the production value to be professional and like really cool as it was. Yeah, like I said, I'm really excited. I got a bunch of like gear for like the Houston Outlaws. That'll be the team I support. So I got a shirt, I got a hat, I got a lanyard, got a jersey. So I'm ready, man. I'm ready. Starts in 5 days. Starts on Wednesday.
You said that they're
What
not
do you think of
gonna
that?
they're not gonna stream it on Twitch, or are they gonna stream it on a different
That yeah.
website?
So they're doing it on MLG.TV. Which is kind of weird, but at the same time, MLG.TV, and I see why, because MLG.TV, I don't know if you've ever been on there before, but if you go on there, on the right side where you can like there's different tabs, like you have the chat and stuff like that. There's also something where you can see like player profiles for like the players that are playing. You can look at their app, their like look if they're support, you can see their average heals or their average defense a game or something like that. If they're DPS, how many eliminations they have and stuff like that, and keeping track of like their overall season stats as well as the series stats, which is really cool. Like it like they really flaunt that with like the Call of Duty stuff, like Call of Duty World League and stuff like that, which is kind of cool. Being able to see like player profiles and stats, and you can also do like predictions of like who's gonna win. And Twitch doesn't really offer that, like. You have to go to like an external site. However, I do see if Overwatch League is really, really successful, which I think it like as successful as I think it's going to be, then I think that might be Twitch's next big thing they kind of go towards is creating this sort of because every other esports on Twitch, you know, like literally every other esport is. So they're going to try to bring Overwatch League over that, and this is just my prediction. They're going to incorporate some sort of player profile thing on the side where you can go into a different tab but remain on the same page, and be able to look at these stats, and that's the only edge that MLG.TV has over Twitch. So that has to be the reason why they decided to go that way.
Yeah, because when I started hearing about all this Overwatch League stuff, I'm like, oh damn, like Overwatch is growing like a lot. I mean, Overwatch is one of the most popular multiplayer games out there, and a lot of people love to play it. It's very competitive and
Very.
balanced in a way. Obviously, no character is better than the other. Each character has his own flaws, and it's crazy how much Overwatch has grown and expanded and gotten bigger over the years, and now it has a league and just so much money coming from it, and it's crazy. It's honestly crazy. You know, a lot of our Twitch friends play Overwatch and they're very good at it and very competitive at it, and it's mind-blowing how big Overwatch is. You know, how about that For Honor, you know,
I
that.
remember they were gonna start like a league with that game and stuff like that, and they just never. I remember being just so excited for that game like years ago when they first announced it, like E3 2015, seeing like the first trailer, and I was like so hyped for it. And at the time, nobody was talking about it, and then all of a sudden they like it come back again, the following year, and then like talk more about it, show more, and then people finally start to get hype over it, and then what they release is like just so. I wouldn't say it was the biggest letdown of a video game ever, but it was definitely like high up there. Like I definitely had fun moments playing that game, but it for a game that was supposed to be like they're supposed to take pride in like having like really good like a really good combat system, which it was a new combat system, like a combat system nobody's ever seen before, which intrigued a lot of people, including myself. And it could have been really successful, but they just couldn't get it right. Like it was just not optimized. Button registration was really bad, which obviously causes rage and stuff like that. So, and on top of it, like game, like the servers were always messed up.
Oh my
I think
God.
they're like even to this day, I don't think the server like
Yeah.
people dropping out like un like at a, unexpectedly and stuff like that. So,
Yeah, like you just
just
get
bad, man.
you're playing and all of a sudden like, oh, looking
Just
for a match or
not
leaving
great.
match, or you just get dropped out of nowhere, like, wow, really? Okay, thanks. But yeah. For Honor was a fun game, it had its fun moments, but it just wasn't executed properly. I wanted to like be competitive with that game and whatnot, and people just were,
Doo-doo heads.
yeah, doo-doo heads, pretty much. Yeah, let's put it that, doo-doo heads in the game. That was a disappointing game. Another disappointing game for me was Battlefront 2. It.
And like we haven't like I haven't actually like been able to sit down and talk to you about this, because obviously this is a game, this is a series of games that like we genuinely care about, and we both saw, set Twitch aside, we just saw us having a lot of fun with the game.
Oh yeah, we put in
And
so many hours into the game. It's
now,
ridiculous.
do you think, let me ask you this though, do you think because we had so much fun playing the first game, we put so many hours into the first game, you think it set like kind of like this unrealistic expectation that
Yes.
this was supposed to be, that times like a million?
Yes. Okay. Loot boxes and stuff, I don't really care that much as people are making it out to be. Sure, it's kind of a shitty system, but what I was looking forward to is the gameplay. Yeah, really just the gameplay, and it felt solid. It felt like definitely an improvement from the first game, but there's just something about it that just. I streamed Battlefront like a couple days ago, Battlefront 2, and I got bored after like 45 minutes. Like I just couldn't get myself to play it as much anymore, and it makes me sad because like that was my game, you know, like Battlefront 2015, that was my game, and I was like, Battlefront 2 is gonna be my game also. It's gonna be bigger, better, more maps, more heroes, better gameplay, and it's just kind of flopped in a way for me. It's not a bad game. It was just something that I was totally not expecting.
Okay. So really your thing is about the and or I guess lack of.
Yeah.
Like, there's just not enough to do.
Yeah, not enough game modes. Hero versus
So do
villains, you have
you
your
think
spinners.
yeah. Do you think that like they obviously they've promised free DLC and stuff like that for the life of the game. And assuming they still do that, because obviously that's under controversy right now. Do you see the game just in general picking it back up once they start releasing more of that content? Or do you see it being or do you see it being more of like the same situation we have with Battlefront 1, where obviously it was four separate DLCs, but they released it like 4 months at a time, and then like it would get a surge in gameplay, but then after like 2 weeks, like that's what it felt like, 2 weeks, and it would just die back down again.
Yes, with the DLCs, I'm glad it's free and whatnot, but I just want like more. I want more game modes.
Yeah.
The DLCs were okay. I played as Finn and Phasma. They're all right. They're but we're at but I want to play as Grievous, Windu, Obi-Wan. With the first Battlefront, I had a lot of fun with Outer Rim. Outer Rim was probably my favorite DLC, but every DLC after that was kind of flopped. It Bespin looked nice. Don't get me wrong, Bespin looked nice. It was beautiful, but eh. And the Death Star was just oh my god, dude. The Death Star DLC was so bad. I
Yeah, and
woke
like
up
what's sad, what's
I woke up at 3 in the morning to download the
I see that, yeah.
DLC, stream like 12 or maybe 24 hours. The first hour, I was bored with it. I was like, wow,
Yeah.
this is all it has? Like, this is like, I'm not trying to sound like a spoiled gamer with that, but with the new DLC, you're expecting, a good amount of content, but the Death Star was just so bad. I didn't like
Yeah.
it. And then Scarif, I like Scarif. Scarif DLC was
Yeah,
cool.
Scarab was pretty cool.
Yeah,
Scarab was pretty
with
cool.
the game mode where you have to infiltrate
Yeah.
the U-wing from the beginning all the way to the gate.
Yeah.
Go in, steal the tapes, and then get yourself back out. That was pretty cool.
That was pretty interesting. Really cool game mode, but yeah, so like back to like what I was saying, do you see it? I guess it's one thing to hope for that, but it's another thing to like see if it's actually like possible for it just to be, like do you see Battlefront 2 being I don't think it's completely dead yet, but do you see it being revived? Is there any way to revive it?
I don't think so.
If so, what would it be? You don't think so?
I mean, obviously, like you said, new DLC is going to come out. A whole surge of players are going to come in, play for like 2, 3 weeks or a
Try the
month.
stuff out and then finish it
Yeah,
and
and
then be
then
on to something else.
go back to like some other game that they're enjoying, that they're consistently
Yeah.
playing. That's just how it's going to be until something like amazing comes out that keeps people playing even longer.
Yeah.
And what that'll be, I have no idea.
So
Until
you don't even have a like an idea of like what you would do in this situation, like if you were EA or if you were DICE, excuse me.
if I were DICE, I would add Extraction. That was a good game mode.
Okay.
I would add more heroes and villains. Like I said, I personally don't really care about the loot boxes and stuff.
Yeah.
You can have all the greatest cards and stuff, but
Yeah, and that's a good point. Like at the start of the game, when obviously the rates were still like you were able to purchase in-game currency and stuff like that. I was already facing people in my first three or four games that had like spent like dropped stacks on them, and I was killing people, or people like one or two people would kill me, and they would have like level 20 something already officers or trooper or assaults or something like that. And then like at the end of the game, I'd finish top of the board,
Yeah, exactly. Like the
and like I'm still dick like that game. I think it's safe to say that Battlefront 2 is a more difficult game to play. Like, it takes, in my opinion, I think it takes skill. I don't think it took a whole lot of skill to play the first game. No, in my opinion.
First one, just run around, shoot, and exactly. Yeah.
And hopefully you can find a hero pickup, you know?
Yeah.
And now it's, you have to actually have to try. And so you can actually, like, be a hero and stuff like that. And honestly, I don't, one of my gripes for the game, I don't think any of the heroes are perfect. I think, like, every hero kind of has, like, a, just, like, this weird thing about them. I would say a lot of them, they just feel too weak. And mm-hmm. I think that obviously that's like a huge like argument with like a lot of people. Like I do think some of them are pretty weak. I'm not saying they need to be as strong as they were first game, but you know some sort of, I mean, damage resistance I need, or something like that. Or that would be really helpful.
Yeah, like in the first game, the heroes were unstoppable. Like you had to get a whole army of infantry to take them down, and I think that's how it should be. With heroes and villains in the Star Wars universe and Star Wars Battlefront games, in the second game they just feel like infantry just with better weapons and better skills. You walk into a room and you're dead. You're so screwed. But like in the first game, in the first game you're Vader or like Luke, you block everything.
Yeah, literally everything.
And like,
I remember from the first game. I didn't mean to cut you off there. No, it's fine. I remember from the first at the start of the first game. Or no, it wasn't right at the start because I remember, and you probably remember this too, but when they first released the game, heroes were timed. So instead of like heroes, like instead of having like a health bar, you still had the health bar, but like your health bar was also a timer.
Mm-hmm.
So your like Vader would be like 120 seconds or something like that. I can't remember. It's been like a long time. But, and like the more people hit you, the less time you had, which obviously like that was a terrible mechanic. I don't know why they did that. Immediately, like in the first patch, it was gone. But at that point, and then at that point, they just increased a lot of the heroes' HP, and they pretty much became tanks. And that was a whole separate like gripe on the game on that game. I mean, that game had a lot of issues, but it was also a really fun game. And I think I don't know, but I also think the same thing with Battlefront 2. I don't hate Battlefront 2. I think it's a good game. I don't think it's a bad game. I think the whole, especially now, if people still talk shit about the loot box thing, about it being tied to the progression system, I don't really believe that shit. Like, I think people are just now making excuses, and they just don't want to put any sort of time. And yeah, okay, like they're gonna say, basically, they're gonna tell me, okay, well, there's some people that don't have the time to grind or whatever. Yeah, okay, well, it took me literally like 4 hours of game time to unlock every hero. Four hours. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, that wasn't the way they originally planned it, and you know, people talking shit and stuff like that, and people complaining, had them change it and stuff like that. But people are still making this excuse and still making jokes about the whole like loot crate system and again being tied into the progression system. That's just a load of shit now.
Mm-hmm.
And I think people just don't want to play the game now because it's not what the influencers are playing. They're going back to the normal game. They're going back to their Counter-Strikes. They're going back to their Call of Duties. They're going back to their Destiny 2. They're going back to their fucking whatever and Battlefields and stuff like that. So I think it has more to do with another thing is I'll say is like once they – in my opinion, they pretty much fixed the whole thing when they took out the in-game currency. In my opinion. The game still wasn't perfect then, but the biggest complaint I thought so was done. I really did. I go, okay, they turned that off. Everything's gonna be okay now. And then people just like kept finding excuses to be mad about. And like you have people that are mad. They don't want to play the game because of like, oh well, I why can I play Darth Maul on Hoth, against stormtroopers? Like really? That's the reason you don't want to play the fucking game? Really? Like, fuck! Like that's dumb. That's stupid.
Yeah, like how you.
Like I feel like DICE and EA, like they can literally do. They can literally be like tomorrow. They could tweet out if you one were price slashing the game. The game is now $30 anywhere. Base price like is $30 now. We're still doing free DLC. Once you get the game, you're gonna have every hero already, and there's just going to be one of those little fucker on like the Battlefront Reddit, which is one of the most toxic Reddits that you can ever be on, and he's going to be like, so
I just think that it's not fair that the assault class has a really good blaster to start off with, so I'm just not going to play that because I usually play specialist, and the specialist starting gun is pretty bad. So, you know, fuck EA, loot crates low, Omega low.
It's dumb. They, like, EA and DICE, they're and obviously EA is a shit company. Like, I'm not gonna try and defend EA. It's more of DICE because DICE is a good company. They have really good people, and I hate seeing them getting dragged across the floor because of what EA is trying to force upon people, especially with a name like Star Wars, right? Like, that's so big, even right now, especially over the last few years. But man, like, it's just I don't want to call Battlefront 2 a lost cause. I still have hope for it, but it's just like they can literally do anything, and like I just feel like they're still not going to win people over.
Oh yeah, I definitely agree with you.
Like, it's the player's fault at this point, in my opinion. It's the player's fault. It's not DICE's fault.
Yeah, like
I I just went on a rant.
No, it's fine. No, I could.
Like, this is a passionate subject for both of us. Yeah, for a lot of people that we know, and we have input that some people just don't. They don't have that input, so.
Yeah, because the fact that we've been playing this game for so damn long, and
yeah,
we've been through everything with Battlefront from 2015 to now, from the one shot Lando shot in the first game. Oh my god, that was such a rough time.
Just imagine the people that were complaining about this game had to play through that shit.
That was a dark time. Lando
could literally one shot you from. Map one shot you
one shot
like Vader you were Vader and he would one shot you and that was in the game for like 4 months because the only ever time they updated the game was when they released the damn DLCs. I don't understand.
I definitely agree, dude.
That game died way too early, and the reason that the first Battlefront died way too early is because they did not sustain it. That is why.
Yeah, they every time,
and, I mean, there was a lack of content at the beginning of the game, but it's mostly because they didn't sustain it.
Oh yeah, and then when the game, when Battlefront 2015 came out, four maps,
three heroes apiece on the light side and the dark side. Which, by the way, at the start of the game, the light side heroes Luke, Han, and Leia were absolutely terrible. You could not win a freaking game of heroes versus villains as the light side, ever. It was so bad.
Vader was such. Was it? Absolute tank. Still is to this point.
He's crazy. He's crazy.
Absolute tank. Takes so much damage.
Like, I would rather go against one of like an AT-ST. Like, I would rather literally be like an officer in Battlefront 2 with my little ass blurg with like fucking explosive rounds and improved burst against a fucking AT-ST than literally go against any form of Vader, especially from the first fucking game.
Oh man, I okay, with everything you said, I agree. Starting with the Battlefront Reddit, I remember I went in one day, scrolling through the topics and everything, and then I clicked on one, and it was a guy complaining like, "Oh, they gotta fix like the cross arrow stuff. Like, why is Rey fighting Maul on Naboo? Like, it's like, shut up! Like, that's awesome. I know it's not canon or whatever, but it's still fun to see. It's part of the game. Yeah. It gives you more options to just imagine that. Imagine they restricted heroes. Like, you can only play these certain type of heroes on this map during this era. That'd be so shitty. That would honestly be very shitty. I just don't understand why people are complaining about that.
It's just the thing to do now, you know? It's just memes and stuff like that. And again, we go back to these people these influencers, and I made a post on Twitter about these people that EA pick to go to, you know, like E3 and EA Play and stuff like that, to be like these people. And I'm not saying all of them, right? Like, huge shout outs to like Battlefront Updates and Dash Star and Star Wars Explained. And even though I give these guys shit a lot because I don't really watch their content, but Star Wars HQ, I get it. I get why they pick them, right? But like, you also have these people that like. Because they're just people know them. That's it. Like, they don't play their games. And like, they also shit on these games too. That's what I don't understand. You constantly call on these people to like advertise your game, and then like they will literally like play it for 2 weeks on their stream or on their YouTube, get their revenue out of what they want to get out of because it's still a new game, whatever, and then move on back to something else. Move on back to whatever they want. And then when people like bring it up, they're like, why would I play that shit game? And then they continue to get like, you know, invited to these expos. Like I don't understand.
Yeah, I
don't get it. And that just makes it so toxic. And that just, and that we're seeing the repercussions of that now, because these influencers are telling these people that you shouldn't be getting these games because of loot crates and fucking playing raid against Darth Maul too. You know, like, people are so easily influenced. And like it's swaying them to like never touch these games,
mm-hmm.
And it's annoying.
Like, there's someone that we know that said, "I'm not gonna buy Battlefront 2 because of loot crates." Like, that's the sole reason why they're not playing it. Like,
yeah,
dude, shut up! Like, there's so much more to the game than loot crates that make the game fun.
Yeah,
but like.
Yeah, like I'm not defending, like I'm not trying to defend the game.
No,
it has
yeah.
its flaws.
Yeah,
I can see why people were like driven away from it, but like stop trying so hard to like make sure nobody plays this game. Like stop, because it's not a bad game. And like yeah, they fucked up. I'm like okay, anybody would be willing to admit that they fucked up.
Mm-hmm.
But they're trying to fix it, and you need to let them. You have to let them.
Mm-hmm.
Give them a chance. That's all I'm saying.
Man, Battlefront 2 and Battlefront will always have a special place in our hearts. Just the fact that everything that we've been through with it and the amount of friends we have made on Battlefront and everything, it'll always have a special place in my heart.
Yeah.
It's just the way Battlefront 2 went about it. Oh, yeah, and my brother, he bought me a gift card. To get 2,100 crystals on Battlefront 2, and I literally can't redeem
you
it.
You can't use them, yeah.
I literally can't redeem this, dude.
Deactivated, so.
Like, what the fuck? Like, can I, like, yeah. I don't understand, dude. Like, I remember Mullet gave me a code for 500 crystals, and that was pretty dope. I used them, and, nice. Like, it... Battlefront 2, man. Anyways.
Yeah.
With Battlefront 2, is there, like, something that you like about it? I know that we kind of shitted on it. We liked it. We don't like it at the same time. But, like, do you like that there's classes now? Like, Assault Officer, Specialist?
I love the class. Yeah, I love the class-based system. I love the gameplay. I think it plays way better than the first one. I think the gameplay of it is really good, really solid. The flying is a lot better.
Oh, yeah, the flying.
But it's a lot better.
So much more better.
Nobody talks about that. Like, people, Fighter Squadron was probably tied for the least played game mode on the first game besides Hero Hunt. And, like, because the flying in that game was terrible. But the flying in this game is really good. This mechanics, like the mechanics of the game, are really well polished. I like them. Like I said, it's not a boring game. It's just, I don't know, man. Too much negative media around it. Obviously, it's just such a Debbie Downer on it. And of course, like I said, the lack of game modes and stuff like that, lack of variety, obviously pushes a lot of people away.
Mm-hmm. You know? All right. Speaking of Star Wars, let's talk about The Last Jedi.
Okay.
Okay, The Last Jedi, this is my opinion on it. I liked it.
All
right. I enjoyed it.
This is where we're going to start arguing.
Okay. I liked it. I enjoyed it. I had, it's not my most favorite movie. There's some parts that were questionable. The humor was all right. Like, the whole Hux and Poe. At the beginning, like, hello, is Hux there? Anyone there? Like, it's like, okay, I get it. It's Disney. They're trying to incorporate to appeal to the kids, right?
I guess I'm a freaking kid because I thought that was hilarious. I thought it was hilarious. Poe is my favorite character, like in the whole new trilogy, whole new stories. Like Poe is by far my favorite character.
I did like Poe's like authority when he
his progression in this movie was awesome.
Yeah,
I think they did a really good job with Poe's character. But I don't see anybody complaining about Poe. I see a lot more people complaining about other people, but we'll get into that a little bit later.
Yes. Rose was completely pointless. I did not like Rose at all. She just had absolutely no reason to be in the movie. I still don't like Finn, personally. I don't like Finn at all. He's just...
When you say still don't like Finn, did you not like him in the first movie?
No. I didn't like him in episode 7.
Okay.
I don't hate him. I just don't really like...
You're not keen on him.
Of his character. Let's see. The whole Princess Leia fight through space using the Force was very...
Out of nowhere
and very strange.
It was really misplaced. And, like, I remember watching it. I got to watch it with... we both just kind of, like, constantly, like, looked at each other. We were like, did that just happen? Like, it was kind of hard to believe, you know? Like, you just were like, what? Like, okay. So... unexpected. That was by far the weirdest part.
Same here.
That was the part that was really questionable for me.
It was when I first saw it, I was like, okay, so this is how they're gonna kill off Leia. Like, all right, kind of too early in the movie to kill her off like that, but okay, I'm cool with that. Whatever she.
Well, and like for me, it's like it was like a catch-22 for me, because if that was the way that she died, I would have been kind of upset. I thought she deserved a much better death than that. I really did. And so, like, yeah, the whole scene was kind of weird, but I'm kind of glad that's... Like, I just... When I first saw, you know, like, obviously, like, they shoot the cockpit, and, like, she gets sucked into space, and, like, you see all of that, you see that whole motion. In terms of cinematic, like, production quality and stuff like that, it was cool, but, like, for someone as, like, sacred as, like, Princess Leia... I just don't think that she deserves something like that.
Yeah.
You know
how in the trailer they showed Kylo like flying through space?
Like aiming at her.
Yeah.
Like he was about to press a button or stuff like that. Yeah.
And then in the movie he doesn't, and it's his fighters that do it for him.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that was... That got me. That tricked me. I mean, I know I should have expected better, or like...
Right.
But I thought Kylo, to get more into the dark side, he would have killed Leia to, like, go more of the good side. Since
try to, like, keep forcing himself back down that path and stuff like that?
Yeah, because he's still split. Even at the end of the movie, he's still, like, split in the middle. I like Kylo. The whole scene with him and his without his shirt on, talking to Rey. Oh my god, there's so many memes about that.
yeah, so many. I saw, I think Gamer sent me this meme on iFunny, and it was pepperonis on his nipples, and like he had like a pepperoni, or like a pizza delivery hat with like a pizza box, like the Spider-Man 2 pizza theme was singing, like going over. You gotta be kidding me. Come on.
That was funny. I saw the one where, you know how Luke was drinking milk out of those animals?
Yeah, the blue milk, yeah.
Yeah, there was one where, like,
Luke
squizzes out of Kylo's nipples and starts drinking the milk. Yeah. Oh my god, dude.
Yeah.
Luke's character, I'm split on how Luke was portrayed in this movie. I was hoping he'd be more like a master, more like a, like, all right, Rey, I'm going to train you. Like, you know, I'm gonna be the best master you'll have, cause Luke was this bright-eyed kid from all these movies, and he was such a hopeful, happy guy, and he was like, whatever it took, he would do it. So I was hoping maybe like he took that with him from Return of the Jedi to him now, but he was just such like a grumpy old man. Want nothing to do with Rey. He wanted to die on there, which I understand why, because he, failed Kylo, and
right.
He's like, what I don't understand is like he saw a little bit of dark side in Kylo, and just wanted to kill him. Like
right,
that's not Luke. Like, Luke... No. That's just not Luke Skywalker. Luke Skywalker is a smarter man. He's just not gonna kill someone just because he sees a little bit of dark in him.
Well, he thought it was too late. Like, he just failed him as a master, and just, like, the darkness just kept consuming it. And, like, in my opinion, when he finally realized that it was too late, it's like there was no other choice. And in my opinion, I thought he had to make the choice. I guess this is an unpopular opinion. And me and my dad kind of, like, had this fight over the phone about it because he despises the way they play Luke's character. And, like, I'm completely on the opposite. Like, I really, really liked Luke's character. I really did. And I really saw the progression with him through the movie, kind of like Yoda's, just in the sense where, like, okay, there's this person on my freaking right in front of me now who wants me to train them. I'm grumpy. I'm old. I just want to be left alone in a desolate space with nobody's around me. And it'll take a little bit of convincing, and then I'll, okay, yeah, sure, we'll train you. You know? I saw a lot of similarities with Yoda in that. Now, obviously, it wasn't exactly the same. They can't do that, of course. But, like, I saw, I don't know, that whole thing with him and Rey, and him being hard on her, I saw, you know, flashbacks of The Empire Strikes Back, and I loved it. I thought it was great.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I see, yeah. Okay. What do you think of Rey in this movie?
Rey was cool. I'm still... I loved her as a character. I was really disappointed about the whole parent thing. I think a lot of people were. I was really excited to just kind of see who the parents were. And I wasn't really wanting... Like, you know, I didn't like the whole thing with, like, Luke being her father or anything like that. I was convinced of, like, if she had to be anybody's relative in the Star Wars universe, I would want it to be Obi-Wan Kenobi's. And when we found out that, like, they were nobodies, that was kind of disappointing. Like, I at least wanted, like, a name and a face. Like, they could be completely new to Star Wars. They could be completely new to the universe. But I at least want a little lore on the parents, and I want to see faces. I want to have names, and just in, like, at least a last name. Like, what's her last name? You couldn't tell me the last name, really? Like, even if it's a completely different last name than anybody we've ever seen before, it's fine. I don't care. That was probably the only thing that was disappointing. I liked the whole train. I liked how her training went with Luke. I like, because we still, there's like an aura of mystery with her. Like, we still don't know if she's going to be, like, fully on the light side. And obviously, like, she's not going to be part of the dark side. I'm convinced that's the case. Like, Rey might be the first person we see that's, like, kind of rides the line. Mm-hmm. And I would like to see that in the last movie, where she kind of rides the line, and, like, at the end, she just becomes, like, I'm just in the fort, like, the Force runs through me, and I just do whatever it takes for the Force to keep balance. And then she just, like, devotes herself to being a Grey Jedi, because I think that would be awesome. And yeah, I just Rey was, but overall, like, good performance. I liked, we got more progression out of it with her, and continuing to do so. So I would have liked to see a little bit more of her.
Lineage
of her, like, yeah, her lineage, and then also the extent of her power and stuff. We didn't really see a whole lot of that.
Yeah, like the scene right before she's, like, got about to meet her parents, that I thought that was cool, when she, like, snaps her finger. It's just like 100 other Reys snapping their fingers. Yeah. I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah, it was pretty cool
seeing, like, how powerful she can be, and how good of a a saber wielder she is, like a fighter. Oh yeah, before I bring that up, with the whole Snoke scene, I was very disappointed that they killed off Snoke.
I'm so happy. I was so glad.
What?
Snoke as a character. Dude. I fucking hate Snoke as a character.
Why?
Because it was so annoying. Like, I was able to deal with the whole, like, Rey being, like, I didn't like the whole Rey being related to Luke thing, but at least I tolerated it. The fact that people wanted to say, like, Snoke can't be new. He has to be Plagueis. He has to be one of these old Sith lords from long ass time ago. Like, fuck that. I thought the way they introduced him in The Force Awakens was fucking terrible. I hated it. I did not like him. He was not menacing. What was the point? We saw, like, we didn't see him do shit in Episode 7, and then we see him at Episode 8, and he's little, like, this little, like, scrawny ass old man sitting in a fucking chair. I wish his death was even worse than what it was. I hated Snoke. And it's sad because I love Andy Serkis as like a motion actor. Like, he's the one that played the motion actor of Snoke. And he's the same guy that's done Smeagol from, like, Lord of the Rings and stuff like that. I love Andy Serkis. I love him. He also played Caesar in Planet of the Apes. But my freaking God, I hated Snoke. There was no lore with him. He didn't do anything. He was the worst victim in the entirety of Star Wars. I would have rather them brought back Newt Gunray to be, like, the main villain for this fucking series than Snoke. I am glad he's gone. I'm glad he died abruptly. Yeah, see ya, Snoke. I'm not going to miss him. He did not contribute whatsoever, in my opinion.
I mean, I was hoping.
I hated him.
I was hoping Snoke would be more menacing and more evil than Palpatine once. And
he had the look. He had the look.
Yeah.
Right. Like, he was a very menacing looking person. But, like, man, maybe because they executed his character wrong. But man, I did not like Snoke.
Did you like the way that Kylo killed him off?
I mean, it was fine. Like I said, it's. It was an appropriate death for, you know, just someone that I don't think he really added a whole lot. Clearly he didn't have that much of a grasp on Kylo's sense of loyalty if he didn't expect Kylo to just, like, cut his fucking body in half. You know what I'm saying? Like, oh, you're so one with the Force and you have such a grasp on this quote-unquote weak person, but then you had no idea he was going to fucking next to you. Come on, man. Your moves are weak. Like, I don't care. I don't know. I'm baffled. I'm just glad he's gone.
Yeah, like, I was very, my jaw dropped when the saber cut through him and he was dead. And because I was hoping maybe in episode 9 we would get, like, a huge chunk of his lore. Or maybe in episode 8 we would have seen more of Snoke, but we barely saw anything of him.
Yeah, and, like, kind of what I was hoping would happen, my predictions, like, back in the day, years ago, like, Kylo was going to be turning into the turn to the light side. Like, Rey was going to help him, and that's kind of what we got in this movie, obviously, right? Like, that's kind of what they played us on to do. And like, he does that, and I'm like, cool, this is it. This is the scene, like, he's going to go to the light side now. And then the last movie is going to be, fuck the rest of the First Order. Like, Hux is going to, like, be, like, crazy deranged now and, like, literally just start, like, nuking every freaking planet in their space just to fucking look for these people. And, like, they're going to, like, her and him are, like, going to take him down together and stuff like that. That was my prediction. Yeah. And that's kind of what I was leaning towards. And then, I don't know. I like the never-ending conflict between Rey and Kylo, though. Like, it's really cool. I like Kylo. Kylo now, like, his scene near the end of the movie where he was, you know, he came, like, when he came out of the AT-AT after, like, they, you know, like, they shot at Luke, like, 50 million times. I love it when, like, My favorite scenes of Kylo is when he goes insane. Like, the end of episode 7, where, like, he gets, like, you know, after he gets shot by Chewie and, like, he sees him in, like, the snowy forest. Mm-hmm. And he's screaming at them and sweating. I fucking love that. and then the end of this movie where he's like, don't fucking stop shooting at him. And then he comes out and just like rushing him and stuff like that. That is awesome. That is awesome. That is when – that's the, like the best time for like – that's like Kylo's time to shine. And I love it. I wish there was more. But it's really cool. I liked his progression as a character too. And I don't know, man. Like I said, I sound like I'm sucking this movie's dick right now, and I guess I kind of am. I really enjoyed it, and I have absolutely no disrespect to anybody that like either is indifferent about it or just hated it.
Yeah.
But I don't know, man. It's just I loved it. It was different, and that's like what everybody asked for, and they got something different, and it's just like, what the fuck is this? This isn't Star Wars. It goes back to Battlefront and Battlefront 2.
Yeah, they did take a completely different angle with this movie. And
yeah.
Some I enjoyed, some I didn't. Like I said, the whole Snoke scene. Because to me, personally, Snoke... I was hoping for Snoke to be like this huge menacing, like evil character. Like that has way more control of the Force than Palpatine ever did. And... scary, intimidating, but he just got cut in half and now he's dead. So now, like, with the whole like at the end of the movie, you saw that kid that used the Force to bring the broom to himself, and now there's kind of no what the hell's gonna happen in episode 9.
Yeah,
you know, like there's kind of no build up now, there's no speculation for what's gonna happen. It's just like, okay, well, they killed everyone off. The rebellion's back together. Well, the resistance, whatever.
Yeah.
And okay, now what? Also, I did not like the casino scene. That was
what, man?
I loved it. I just it was so unnecessary. I like the when they're like escaping from the
like
cops. The
prison and stuff like that with like the
With the animals.
When they grab the animals and stuff.
Yeah, that was, I like that. That was cool. But I thought there was like sort of an underlying message of like, don't abuse animals. Animals are people. Like, don't get me wrong, I love animals. But like they kind of threw like a little SJW kind of message in there, like with the don't keep animals in captive. Animals are people too. It's don't abuse animals. I don't know. That's kind of what I sensed a little bit when they were releasing, when Rose was talking.
Okay.
Gotcha. The whole Finn and Rose subplot was so like I said, I just did not like that. Like, I like a lot of the movie. It sounds like I hate every part of the movie. I don't. But these are just some parts that I just simply just did not like because it was just so unnecessary with Finn and Rose.
Yeah.
Poe's awesome when they were on the ship and fuck, what was the purple haired lady's name again?
Admiral Haldo.
Haldo. I hated Haldo.
Like, I loved her.
I thought she was like, why are you holding out information? Like, tell the damn.
I don't think we'll ever get an explanation for that, but like, I don't know. I thought she... I think Laura Dern's a great actress, and I think she did really well. I thought her performance was good. I guess some of the content, yeah, that's, like, questionable and stuff like that. Why didn't she just tell them, you know, fine, okay, that's an acceptable argument I'll take, like... But I thought it was... I don't know. I liked her character.
Yeah.
She made me hate her, and then it felt me... And then I felt really bad.
Yeah, because she ended up killing herself.
When a character can make me do that, that means... And, like, I will say this. That scene where, like, she goes into hyperspace and, like, slices in half the entire, like, that armada of, like, First Order ships,
mm-hmm.
That is the best, and I will not settle for anything less between anybody. That is the most beautiful and well-made cinematic moment in any Star Wars movie ever created. And I will not argue. I will not accept any other answer. Because that was perfect. You know what I'm talking about? Like, yeah. Slice it in half.
Yeah, and like it goes quiet. Yeah. It goes quiet for, like, a couple seconds. That was very beautiful. That was well done.
Like, that was perfect.
But I think it should have been Leia that should have done it instead of Haldo, because that would have been...
Yeah, that would have been a little more fitting, yeah. Obviously. But, like, Leia, like, we can agree. The whole, like, Leia thing is just, we don't know what the fuck's going to happen.
Yeah, like, she's dead. Like, it's kind of ironic that Mark Hamill and Harrison Ford are alive, but they're dead in the movies.
Yeah, the two dead movies, yeah.
Yeah, but Leia's actually dead, and she's still alive in the movie. Like, that's... ironic.
It'll be interesting how J.J. Abrams deals with that in 9.
I don't know. Maybe they just start out 9 with a funeral of her. Like, oh, Leia died.
Yeah that's kind of what I hope they don't do.
Yeah, like, I honestly don't know what they're going to do. What if, like... Because she died when they were finished... When they finished filming The Last Jedi.
Yeah.
So she... And then they confirmed that they're not going to use CGI on her for episode 9. Yeah. So, like, yeah, I have absolutely no idea how they're going to go on with Leia in episode 9.
Yeah.
But overall, good movie. Wasn't really the biggest fan, like I said, but
yeah.
I still list Empire as my top Star Wars movie. Yeah, Empire... Return of the Jedi, A New Hope, Revenge of the Sith, Rogue One. No. The Last Jedi, Revenge of the Sith, Rogue One, Clone Wars, and The Phantom Menace.
You really put Phantom Menace below Clone Wars? I think Clone Wars is the worst Star
Wars. Yeah, flip-flop that, only because of the mall scene. Like
my road would be A New Hope, Empire. And then, honestly, I've been thinking about a lot about this lately, but it's my third is honestly a toss-up between Return of the Jedi and The Last Jedi. Honestly. Like The Last Jedi is, like, really close to breaking my top three. So, like, those take up my 3 and 4 slots.
Okay.
And then 5, I would put Revenge of the Sith. 6, I would put Rogue One. 7th, I would put Phantom Menace. And then 9, I'd put Clone Wars.
Okay. What about the Christmas special?
Christmas special is, like, in a whole other room.
Okay.
It's not touching this list.
I'll be honest, I haven't watched it. I watched the first 10 minutes of it with my girlfriend.
It's an experience.
It was very, from what I've seen, was different. I'll just put it that.
It's just like an hour, a little over an hour of cringe. That's pretty much all it is.
Yeah.
Star Wars. Yeah. Star Wars stuff.
Oh, man. Also, with The Last Jedi, do you like the idea that anybody can, like, be force sensitive, or that somebody has to be the daughter or the son or whatever of someone else that has the force?
Oh yeah, like a lot of people didn't read any sort of comics or anything like that led up to The Force Awakens. But there was a particular one, like a 3 or 4 issue comic series of Star Wars, like Journey to The Force Awakens. And it talks about Poe's mom and dad being, like, members of the rebellion during the Battle of Endor. And they were, like, really kind of, like, high-up officers. And they actually flew with the guy, I already forgot this guy's name, from Shriv, I think is what his name is, from Battlefront 2 campaign. I don't know what his race is either. I forgot what his race was off the top of my head.
No, yeah.
You know what
yeah.
I'm talking about?
Yeah,
the green guy?
Yeah, the alien looking guy?
They flew with him. Like, yeah, he was the alien looking guy? Yes, Gio. Yes, the alien looking guy in the Star Wars game. That helps. But yeah, so they flew with Shriv. Like, they were members of that kind of small battalion with, like, Leia and stuff like that. And when they gave birth to Poe, Luke gave them a tree, like a little baby tree that, like, has, like, it's a Force-sensitive tree, basically. And, like, Force really, like, is concentrated that runs through it. So I think, like, anybody that was, like, around that or anything like, you know what I'm talking about? Like, just anything that was like that, or, you know, they can kind of become Force-sensitive and then, obviously, like, progress forward onto that. The whole being, like, you know, only being able to have the Force because you were either, like, birthed by a woman and then midichlorians or something like that, like, that's cool, too, and stuff like that, but I like the idea that I've always thought Star Wars is what it was. Like, a nobody can become the savior of the galaxy, right? Isn't that what the whole point of the first movie was? Luke Skywalker and Moisture Farmer that, like, from fucking, like, literally in the middle of nowhere on this fucking desert planet, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden he finds out, like, his lineage and, like, literally saves the galaxy multiple times. So, that's how I see it.
Okay.
I hope there's more Force-sensitive people in the galaxy. That's cool. That's more stories. More stories, more heroes. Makes me being during this century, you know, a normal person, like, dream about that. Like, it's okay to be a nobody, and then all of a sudden, you know, the next day you're
saving the galaxy.
Blowing up a star base for the third time.
Okay. What do you have any expectations or anything for the Han Solo movie?
Not really. I'm really expecting, like, Donald Glover to be really good with Lando Calrissian. I think that's really the only expectation that I have, that, like, I feel like I'll get. I think the guy that's playing Han Solo, I haven't seen anything he's done. People were kind of like, when they announced, they already kind of like denounced him as being Han Solo, obviously, because it's not Harrison Ford, oh no. I'm willing to give the guy a shot, though. Hopefully he does well. I would like to see him do well. Yeah. But Han Solo, it was kind of near the bottom of my list to have an anthology movie about. So I'm just kind of going into this movie hoping it's entertaining. I won't be as passionate about this one as I will with all the other episodic movies and stuff like that. So,
what? Who would you like to see a movie made about?
I would really like to see a movie made with Yoda. I remember there was rumors about a year ago that they were considering doing, like, a Yoda and, like, his race trilogy.
Mm-hmm.
With Christopher Nolan. Ooh. Directing.
Okay.
So that would have been, like, crazy. Obviously, like, I haven't heard anything since then. And it was, like I said, it was just a rumor. Like, it probably was just nothing. But that would be fucking dope.
That would be insane, too.
Yoda's pretty high up there just because we just don't know anything about him. Darth Maul would be pretty cool. A lot of people want Boba Fett. Boba Fett would be kind of cool, but, you know, I don't know. Again, he's kind of low on my list. And then obviously I would like to see, like, kind of like Old Republic characters. Darth Bane would be pretty cool. Darth Bane would be really interesting. I think if they were to do a Darth Bane movie or series of movies, and like the whole cult of Bane and stuff like that, it would kind of have to be rated R because it could have some fucked up stuff, like sacrifices and shit like that. So, I like to see Yoda more than anything, though. I guess to answer your question, Yoda would definitely be my number one.
Did you hear that there's rumors that an Obi-Wan movie is going to...
Yeah. Obi-Wan is... I don't know why I'd even say that. Obi-Wan's pretty high on my list, too. Just I would love a movie of his adventures, obviously, between Episode 3 and Episode 4. I think everybody wants to see that. Of course, starring Ewan McGregor.
Mm-hmm. That'd be kind of dumb if they had anybody else played Obi-Wan. Yeah,
it wouldn't really make any sense, because he's, like, the perfect age right now. Like, Ewan would be the perfect age to bridge between the two.
Yeah, because... I mean, they probably I have him play maybe more when after Revenge of the Sith.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. And like Ewan McGregor has said multiple times that he's like, yeah, dude, hell yeah, I'm willing to do it. Like, let's get it, let's do it. Why aren't we doing it yet?
Yeah, hell yeah.
Like, he's 100% open to doing it. I don't know why they're not.
Would you want to see a movie on Chewie?
I mean, not really, but only because the Wookiee race never really entered, like, I don't know. I guess it's a subjective question. Just like, I guess any of the questions that we've been asking each other. I like the Wookiee race and stuff like that. I just don't find them, like, all that interesting.
Hmm.
I like Kashyyyk, though. Kashyyyk's a cool planet.
Very beautiful planet.
Yeah.
Very nice looking. And Battlefront 2 looks really, really nice.
Yeah, I would definitely say Kashyyyk is probably the most, one of definitely the most beautiful planets on Battlefront 2. Like, both daytime and nighttime.
Yeah, definitely. It really is. What about Lando?
Lando would kind of be cool, but I feel like it'd be kind of similar to Han's, really. Both, although I would say Lando probably wouldn't make this same decisions, I guess, what we've known Han to make. Like, Han always ends up picking to save people.
Mm-hmm.
And they will probably wouldn't do that a lot of times. But besides that, I think a lot of the stuff would be the same, really.
Them yeah.
Being, you know, robbing stuff and being a scoundrel. Nothing would be different.
What I'm hoping to see in the Han Solo movie is the card game where Han wins the Millennium Falcon.
Yes, Sabacc.
Yeah,
I'm so confident they're gonna show that. Like, there's no way they.
Yeah, like I honestly want to see that.
So surprised if they didn't.
Yeah, because like I've read that Han wins a card game and Lando pretty much bets the Millennium Falcon.
Yeah.
And he loses, so I definitely would love to see that. See that scene. But man, so many. Star Wars movies coming out, so many Star Wars things on the rise. It's a good time to be a Star Wars fan.
Really is.
But been going out for like 2 hours now.
I feel like it's been longer than that. It's only been 2 hours.
Well, 2 hours and like 20 minutes.
Gotcha.
Yeah, you just wanna. Ended right here.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, I hope you got enough content.
No, we need about 4 more hours.
4 more hours. All right, cool. Let me go grab some G Fuel.
All right. Okay. Well, thank you so much, Piff Batman, for coming on to the podcast. I definitely enjoyed this conversation with you. It has been.
Thank you for having me. I feel really honored to be the first guest on here, and I hope the rest of the episodes are this cool and this fun, and I just know that it's going to keep getting better and better, so good luck with that.
Thank you, and I appreciate you having you on here. Maybe one day down the road we'll have an IRL podcast.
Yeah.
We're face-to-face asking each other questions and stuff and having a conversation. But this has been a lot of fun.
Absolutely.
It's very interesting to see where this series will go. I'm going to have to see where guest number two, who's that going to be. And hopefully maybe down the road we'll have another podcast together.
Yeah, definitely. I'm always more than welcome to be a part of the show.
For sure. So Piff Batman, twitch.tv/PiffBatman. If you guys want to check him out, cool guy. Cool streamer, and all right, Battlefront player, but you know.
Yeah, that's what it is.
No, but thank you everybody for watching. I appreciate you guys, and have a good rest of your day. Bye.
See ya.